So hello students and viewers, how are you all? I hope all of you are fine and safe. This is your Arindam sir and you are watching Revision Learning. So students, today in this video lecture, we are going to start a new chapter from your history, class 8 history. Today we are going to start the chapter number 3, Rural Life and Society. So what basically we are going to study in this chapter? In this chapter, we will learn about the system of revenue collection by the British East India Company. In this chapter, we will learn about how British East India Company got the rights of collecting the revenue from the Indian people and what was their system. Now, during that time, we know that agriculture was the primary source of income or primary source of cultivation during that time in the 18th century in India. So, to collect the revenue, the British East India Company had to collect the revenue from the agricultural source, from the farmers and peasants. So, by doing that, there were many problems and some solutions were also sorted out. Solutions like the permanent system, Mahalwari system, Rayatwari system, these systems were introduced. We will discuss these things in details. In another portion of the chapter, we will see that indigo crop. The cultivation of indigo was selected and it was forced to all the Indian peasants to cultivate the indigo. It was forced by the British East India Company so that they can export this indigo to the Europe, as the demand of indigo was very much high in Europe. Due to this, the problems were found in indigo plantations in India, and as a result of which, the Blue Rebellion was started. So we'll discuss everything in details. Today in this video, what we will do, we will discuss basically about the system of revenue collection and the permanent system. Okay, so this is the first part of the video or the first part of the chapter, you can say, and in this part we will only focus on the system of revenue collection and permanent system. In the next part we will bring up our other topics. So let's start the discussions in details. So in the 18th century, we know that the 18th century belonged to the British East India Company, the modern Indian history, you can say. So in the 18th century, India was well known as an agricultural country. Okay, India was basically known for the agriculture. Majority of the people depended on agriculture. Okay, now India also led a prominent place in the world in the field of handicraft production. This is, I think you don't know, but during that time, India also had some good hands in their handicrafts. Okay, handmade decorative products of various cultures, okay, various states, various peoples. India also had the prominent place in the world. One of the prominent place India had in the world in the field of handicraft production, handmade decorative products, okay, goods, items, everything. But when British East India Company or when the British came, this handicraft production was totally destroyed. Okay, so which resulted in changes in the agrarian structure. So what is agrarian structure? Agrarian structure is the cultivation of land, the structure of the cultivation of land. So this thing totally changed when the British East India Company came. Okay, British introduced many new systems of land tenures and policies of revenue administration. Okay, and which led to the difficulty to the farmers to adjust to the new ruthless policy of revenue collection. What happened that when British stopped or when British destroyed the handicraft production, after that they introduced many new systems for and you can say many new systems or many new policies for the revenue collection and administration of India. So while doing that, they introduced many new or difficult policies. Here I have written one word, ruthless policy, means showing no pity or mercy to anyone. Okay, while introducing new land tenures policies for the revenue collection, the British East India Company introduced many new systems, many new ruthless policies of revenue collection from the farmers, which ultimately resulted as difficult or which ultimately made difficult for the farmers to adjust with those new ruthless policies or systems of revenue collection. Now students, I think you might have one question that why they have introduced new systems or how they got the power. So now when we will read about the system of revenue collection, here this confusion will be cleared. Okay, so now let's see the system of revenue collection. We will read in our chapter number 2 that after the Battle of Plassey and Battle of Boxer, Mughal Emperor was badly defeated by the company, the British East India Company. Now after that there was a treaty, the Treaty of Allahabad, and according to the Treaty of Allahabad, the Mughal Emperor on 12 August 1765 granted the Diwani rights to East India Company. Now what is Diwani rights? Diwani rights means right to collect tax or revenue from someone. This type of rights, that is the rights to collect tax or revenue, was given to the British according to the Treaty of Allahabad by the Mughal Emperor. Okay, Mughal was there, but to collect the revenue from the people of India, from the Indians basically, these rights was given to the British by the Mughal, as they were defeated in the two wars or in two battles. Okay, now after that the East India Company was the Diwani, or the East India Company became the Diwani of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa basically. Okay, and company became chief financial administrator. Okay, as financial administrator, why I said, because all the financial related duties were handed over to the British by the Mughal. Okay, collection of tax or collection of revenue means the collection of money. British East India Company, when they came to India, they came as a trader, okay, for trading something. They came as a trader, they basically only thought of profit, nothing else. They only just thought of their profit and all. Now, as they brought their armies and all, and as they defeated, the present ruler of India, during that time the Mughal Emperor, then the Mughal Emperor signed one treaty. That treaty was the Treaty of Allahabad, and during that treaty, the Diwani rights, that is the rights to collect the tax and revenue, was given to the British East India Company. So ultimately what happened? The British East India Company became the chief financial administrator. All the financial things, that is the collection of tax, collection of revenue, how much tax or how much revenue should collect from which place or from where, everything came under the company. Okay, all the responsibilities of administering the land or organize its revenues, resources, everything came under the company. Now, as they were the traders, basically British East India Company focused more on profit and less on proper administration. They only wanted money, nothing else. Only they wanted money and without any administration. They thought like initially they will get lots and lots of profit from, as they now got the right to collect the tax. They got the right, now they will basically focus on collecting more profit. Okay. So for this reason, the company adopted three types of revenue collection system. But why? Why three types, or why they adopted this type of revenue collection system? The reasons are that company wanted a large revenue income, being the Diwan. As they got the Diwani rights, they were the Diwan. So the company wanted a large revenue income from the Indians. Okay, they were almost settled in India by that time, and within the 5 years, as I said, in 1765 the Diwani rights were given to the British East India Company. So within 5 years the export was doubled. Okay, export means all the cloths, goods, or whatever the things which have been exported or which have been traded from India to Europe, it was doubled. Okay, between these 5 years. Now, being traders, when company used to export, they used to export the cloths, foods, spices to Europe. From India, they used to collect the foods, or you can say the many type of cloths, spices, because these items or these commodities demands were very high in Europe during that time. So the British East India Company, when they were traders, they used to collect these things from India, and in return of that they used to give India silver, gold, coins and so many things. Okay, but now what happened? The export was doubled, okay, but the money or the gold or silver came less. You can say it never came. Revenue collected in Bengal, basically the revenue got, or the collection of revenue started in Bengal. So the revenue collected in Bengal would finance the purchase of goods for exports. Okay, and ultimately crisis and problems were there in Bengal economy. So what I mean to say here that the British East India Company got the Diwani rights. Now they were collecting that, they had the rights of collecting the revenue and collecting the tax from the farmers, from the peasants. Now in this sense, they used to collect the revenue, they used to collect the money from the farmers. The same money they used to give the traders, and in return they used to take the money, or they used to take the cloths, foods or spices, whatever the Indians are going to export to the other countries, it is to the Europe, they used to take it from them, and in return they used to give that money which has been collected from the farmers to same back to the workers, laborers, those who have made the cloths, goods, foods, and whatever the things have been exported. So just imagine, the money which the company is taking from the farmer is again coming back to the workers. The money which they are taking as a revenue from the Indians is again coming back to the Indians. But in this time, or during this time, the export which was earlier balanced, you can say, now it got doubled. And earlier extra income, extra money, or extra gold, silver, so many things were coming to India, but now it's not coming, because the same money that Indians are paying to the British, the same money the British are again paying back to the Indians, but they are exporting things in a double manner. So you can easily expect that there would be crisis and there would be problems, economic crisis, you can say. There would be economic crisis, because extra money or money is not coming to India, but things are going from India to the other parts of the country. So because of this reason, there was a huge economic crisis, and almost 10 million people in Bengal died because of this economic crisis and economic problems. Okay, so for this reason, the company adopted three types of revenue collection. When the company saw that economy, because according to the company, economy is equal to company's revenue. Company officials began to feel that the investment in land had to be encouraged and agriculture need to be improved now, because economy means company's revenue. Now if the economy is going down, that means the company's revenue will also go down. So the company officials now thought that investment in the land should be encouraged. People should be encouraged to invest in the land, and agriculture should also be improved. Okay, so because of these reasons, they imposed three types of revenue collection system. The first system was the permanent system. In your book, it is written that roughly 19% of the total area under the company rule, which covered Bengal, Bihar, Banaras, divisions of the northern western provinces and northern Karnataka, were brought under the zamindari system. Okay, so as 19% of the land of the Bengal, Bihar, Banaras, etc. were under the British, so in those places the permanent system or the zamindari system was imposed. The second revenue system, called the Mahalwari system, it was imposed in those areas where the British had the 30% of the land under the company's area, like for example Punjab, central provinces, northwestern provinces, etc. And the Rotwari system covered the 51% of the land which is comprised by the company, or which is under the company rule. And most of the parts comprised of Bombay, Madras provinces, Assam and certain other parts of the India. Okay, so these three systems are imposed. Now we will discuss about the permanent system. So as the company wanted to invest more in the lands and encourage people to invest more in the lands and develop the agriculture, so they came up with the permanent settlement idea in 1793. Okay, and who introduced this permanent settlement? It was introduced by Lord Cornwallis. Okay, now what is this permanent settlement? Permanent settlement means it's an agreement. Now what type of agreement? It's an agreement between company and zamindars. Okay, zamindars here, it's an agreement basically between the British and the Indians. Zamindars mean they are the basically native people, Indian people. So it's an agreement between the company and the zamindars. Zamindars were asked to collect the rent from the farmers and peasants and pay revenue to the company. Now it was said to the zamindars by the company that they had to collect the rent of the land or the revenue, they had to collect the revenue from the farmers and the peasants, and again they have to pay that revenue to the company back. And the amount of revenue was fixed permanently irrespective of the harvest. Now, whatever the situation of the harvest, it doesn't matter, but the amount of revenue was fixed permanently. Now, it was said that now some zamindars thought like this, that if I collect 100 rupees or 100 rupees as a revenue from one farmer and I should give this 100 to the company, then why I shouldn't collect 150 from that particular farmer? If I collect 150 from that particular farmer, then I had to give back 100 rupees to the company and I will keep 50 rupees with me. So there is an income of 50 rupees for that particular zamindar. Like this, if he collects from 10 farmers, then definitely 500 is his collection from 1 month, you can say. So like this, some zamindars thought like this. So this system encouraged the zamindars. This system proved to be a great boon to some of the zamindars and to the government of Bengal. Okay, as because they fixed the amount of revenue was fixed. Why the amount of revenue was fixed permanently? Because this ensured a fixed amount of revenue income from the peasants, and this encouraged the zamindars to invest in improving the land for peasants. Now, if there is fixed amount of revenue, then from every month fixed amount of revenue would come from the peasants and farmers. And secondly, if the zamindars were given a little bit of power to collect the revenue, then also zamindars will also collect some of the portion or some money from the peasants for them only, and some portions they will give back to the company. This will encourage the zamindars to administer more on the lands, to invest more on the people or on the peasants or on the farmers, and the zamindars can force the farmers to improve the lands, to improve their cultivation. So this was a great boon system for the zamindars. Okay, the main features of the permanent settlement, as I told you, the zamindars of Bengals were recognized by that time. Okay, then amount was fixed, and the ryots, that is the poor peasants, then became the rented peasants. Now earlier some peasants, they don't have their own land, now they got a rented land from the company where they can do their cultivation. So these are the systems, or these are the main features of the permanent settlement. But there was a problem. There are many effects of the permanent settlement. What was the problem? Now we will discuss. The problems was like this. For example, many wastelands were brought under cultivation. Now in some wasteland, you cannot even imagine to cultivate something. But during that time, zamindars forced the peasants to cultivate in the wastelands also, because they wanted to increase the cultivation. If there is more cultivation, then more amount of tax or revenue, you can say, they can collect from the peasants. So taking this into consideration, the zamindars forced some peasants or farmers to cultivate in some wastelands. Then lands were taken away if the peasants failed to pay the revenue. The lands of that particular peasants were taken away if the peasants failed to pay the revenue at the end of the month. Third, the system benefited zamindars more than British, as cultivation was expanded but the rent remained the same. As I said you earlier, that in many places the cultivation was expanded but the rent remained the same, because zamindars used to pay the same amount of revenue, as the amount of revenue was fixed permanently. So taking that rule, the zamindars used to pay same amount of rent to the company, but at the same time they used to collect more revenue from the peasants or farmers. And this system affected some zamindars also, who couldn't make the payment to the company. Some zamindars were not that much clever, so some zamindars got less money from the peasants or farmers. So if those type of zamindars couldn't pay the payment, or couldn't pay the actual payment of revenue to the company in the scheduled time, then they had to lose their zamindaris. Okay, during this system, it has been found that the zamindars were not investing in the improvement of the land. Okay, the revenue had been fixed so high that the zamindars found it difficult to pay most of the revenues. In some cases, as I said you, the zamindars faced many problems. In some cases or in some places, The revenue was high for the zamindars that they found it very difficult to collect from the peasants and farmers, and then they found it difficult to pay back to the company. Okay, anyone who failed to pay the revenue lost his zamindari. Second, and as I said you that in many cases the cultivation of the cultivation was expanded, which means that the increase in the income of the zamindars, but no gain for the company since it has it had the fixed revenue demanded permanently. So this system actually and somehow benefited the zamindars. In some cases the zamindars lost their zamindaris, okay, and in many cases the zamindars were benefited but the company had no gain. So ultimately this system, or you can say the permanent land revenue system of Bengal, failed. So with this today I will end my discussion here. I hope you have understood everything, and ultimately you have understood that after everything this permanent land revenue system of Bengal failed. Okay, so in our next video we will continue our discussion with the Mahalwari settlement or Mahalwari system and the Rotwari system. So students, keep studying, keep learning, and I hope that you have understood everything. If you have any doubts or queries, you can ask me in the comment section below. And if you have liked my explanation, then like this video, share it to your friends, and don't forget to subscribe Revision Learning and press the bell icon so that you never miss any of our videos and updates. Till then, keep studying, keep learning, and soon we will bring our next video where we will discuss the later portions of this chapter. Thank you.